Okay, welcome back to the second part of this morning at the European Film Forum dedicated to data, algorithms, AI, metadata, and all those kind of innovation that can be tools to empower and improve the content industry as a whole. I was promising you before the break that we would target Netflix or tackle Netflix and actually have a brief focus on this pattern with Elena Nera. She's the consultant and owner at La Otra Pantalla. So we're going to see what's happening on the other screen with you, Elena, for the next 10 minutes.
Hello. I'm going to take the water. So good morning, buenos dias, guten morgen. Of course, big data has become a huge asset of the audiovisual business. We've been talking about this for a while now. And a few months ago, Eva Patricia Fernandez, Judith Claris, two fellow professors, and I decided to do some research on how one of the most popular video on demand companies uses big data. What for? To see if we could somehow conclude that part of the success relies in big data and data decision making. So our study was published by an academic magazine, El Profesional de la Información. You can find it on the internet with this very same title. And this is why I'm here today, which I thank to Niombo, Christopher, and everyone involved in the organization. So first question. How many of you have a Netflix account? Oh, okay. So I think this might interest you. So, of course, we all know Netflix. It's the world's leading internet TV network. Their words, not mine. According to the company's fourth quarter 2016 figures, they have more than 86 million of subscribers over 190 countries, and that stream more than 125 million of hours per day. That's really impressive. That's why they got our attention. So the first question we ask ourselves is, why is big data so important for a VOD company? And the answer was actually pretty simple. Because viewing audiovisual content on a connected device, such as smart TVs, laptops, phones, or tablets, makes the user, the viewer, a data generator. So for us, watching Netflix looks like this, but for people working inside the company, it looks like this. This is actually fake, but it was published in the Netflix tech blog. It's like, kind of, it looks the dashboard in Netflix. So, we also had another question. It's what for? And our approach, based on reading and watching all the official information Netflix has released so far, and believe me, it's a lot of information, we could conclude that big data is the key to understand the content they offer, the way they showcase it, the way they stream it on a tech level, and also their global expansion. So Netflix revolves around a strong content efficiency philosophy, because we're talking about a company with a non-advertising model, so you can't forget about the audiences. Netflix profit is proportional to the number of paying subscribers. So they have four main business goals. They to improve membership and member retention, to reduce cancellations and long-term engagement, and of course, a positive user experience. So they want their clients to be satisfied heavy users. That's why they need the content to be efficient so badly, because if they like it, they watch more. I know we've all been there. Yeah, we all have been, all Netflixers are bingers. So efficiency is linked to the number of hours streamed. And if you want to take advantage of big data in your company, first step is making a choice of data sources. And Netflix does so with a business goal in mind, to gain and retain subscribers. So the company needs to know the users well, what are their preferences and their motivations. And how do you get to know your clients? By tracking them. And what do they track? As you can see, a lot of things. The viewed and discarded content type, playback features, if it's normal speed, if it's rewound, forwarded, paused, or abandoned. The playback intensity, the frequency, and the number of hours streamed per session. Also, the rating given by the user and the device used to log in, the paths taken by the user within the app, the location, the time and day, and the technological state of content delivery. Okay. Whoops. And besides choosing data sources, Netflix works very, very hard on metadata. And here's a question for you. Have you ever scrolled through these bizarre categories Netflix displays in your browser? Have you ever? Yes. My favorite is British dramas with a strong female lead. Yes, I'm that kind of girl. And this happens because Netflix analyzes and tags all the movies and TV shows available. Do you want to know how? Yes? Yes. Meet Netflix taggers. Have no audio.
And you had to hope you could find something to watch. Then came Netflix. Did you know? You can watch what you want, when you want, and where you want. Yeah, even there. Your Netflix is tailored just for you. It's personal. We know what you say you like, and what you actually like. By the way, we noticed your gran is a violent revenge thriller aficionado. We are so super accurate that you think we are reading your mind, or your tea leaves. Ever wondered how we do it? We have an army of brainy engineers, super effective top secret algorithms, and a very special discerning viewer whose love for film and TV is so great that they're ready to join our team
of Netflix Taggers.
Taggers are the bright sparks who help us make your Netflix personal. Their analytical minds pick up on the most subtle details. That's why your Netflix profile doesn't look like your grand's. Unless, of course, you two have similar taste. Sounds like a great job, doesn't it? Interested? Then get ready. Netflix is on the hunt for a new tagger from the UK and Ireland. Go to jobs.netflix.com for more details and help us shape the future of television.
I know a lot of you would love to apply the best job in the world. So, as I said, Netflix analyzes and tags every movie and TV show available because they use people trained to watch content. Whoops. And tag it with all kinds of metadata. And as a result, they generate dozens of attributes and content categories. Actually, this metadata combined with millions of users' viewing habits is the competitive advantage for Netflix. So what happens when we have big data ready and available? You need to, the next layer is to analyze it, just to make data useful for you. And here's a fact based on data. Netflix knows there's a lot of content and a very critical 60 to 90 second window. That's the time an average user spends deciding what to watch. And after that period, the chances of finding something to watch drop dramatically. So, categories and content display are actually the perfect sample of this analytical layer. The better Netflix shows it knows the user, the likelier he'll stick around. So based on using patterns and metadata, they develop algorithms to make viewing decisions easier and more satisfactory. So the user interface can show up to 40 selection rows and genres, which tend to correspond to a specific algorithm, and matches user preferences. And by the way, they change all the time. Each time you log into Netflix, the rows may be different because they want us to perceive like this feeling of brand new service each time we log in. So as has been said before, 2 out of 3 hours of play content in Netflix are discovered at this very stage. So this is my user interface in Netflix, and yours will probably look very different. And yes, we're almost there. I know this is what you came for. So the information generated by users' browsing experience in Netflix takes us to the next layer, and the most important one is making database decisions. And of course, House of Cards is the elephant in the room when we talk about big data and producing content. Back in 2012, Netflix decided to create a business unit inside the company to make in-house productions. And they came with this idea of the circles of proven success. They said that overlapping three elements, David Fincher, Kevin Spacey, and the original British show would make a successful entry into original programming. And it went pretty well, actually. So the design of this tailor-made product, it's a clear example of business intelligence. It was not only an artistic or a gut-based decision, it was actually the big data helped them profiling a potential audience with a set of defined dimensions and preferences. So of course, data can tell you how to make a show, but it sure can tell you what show you should be making. And two more things for last, because I have only 10 minutes. I think I'm running out of time, actually. This efficiency in program design, the client awareness, and the opening in new markets have run parallel to the rise of Netflix Original. And Narcos, of course, is an example when they were expanding to Latin America and to Southern Europe countries. And actually, global expansion has allowed them to resize their audience and identify same viewer segments in different territories. Or to put it into another words, their storytelling has gone global. So thank you very much for your attention.
And thank you very much for the illustration, Elena. So now, how can the audiovisual sector benefit from automated tools? Well, first, we'll try to define what an automated tool is, and we certainly target the question of algorithms and whether we should trust them or not. We're the battleground right now when we're talking about, again, data and algorithm to try to defend EUX, to defend cultural diversity. Well, that's one of the many questions we'll definitely tackle with our next guest, Paul Avril, advisor on European affairs at Le Conseil Supérieur de l'Audiovisuel, CSA en France, Andreas Wildfang, executive director and co-owner of EYZ Media, Dimitrios Mitsinikos, co-founder and director of Gower Street Analytics, and last but not least, Mustafa Isik, head of software development and platforms at the Bayerischer Rundfunk. And we'll actually come back to the question of the career of Mustafa in a few, because now you're working for a broadcaster, but you were previously working for Google. So we'll see that we can totally switch from, you know, companies and role, because we are a unique ecosystem, and that, you know, of course, I mean, platforms are part of it right now. But first, let's have a quick reaction on what we just seen with Lena and on the Netflix pattern. There is a specific model applied to Netflix when it comes to algorithms and the way they can be more specific, more efficient on what to recommend to its audiences and viewers. Now, there's also, you know, this question upcoming about the fact that should we have a European algorithm pattern? So do we have to be and go that cultural and that divided into opposing two patterns when it comes to algorithms, one American one or a platform one versus a European one? Maybe first let's tackle this question with you, Andreas, because I know you're fiercely preventing from getting too European when it comes to algorithms.
I don't know if I'm that fiercely. First of all, I think what's interesting is if you look at the origin of the world algorithm, you will find, if you look at Wikipedia, that it's actually stemming from an Arab Muslim from Baghdad from the 800s, which I think is kind of funny now with the ban. But so there wouldn't be any algorithms in the US, you know. So, but having said that, I think... yes, I do have my doubts about taking the US as the very leading model. Mm-hmm. I mean, to explain that a little bit, I mean, we are a company here in Berlin. We do software development, and we run our own VOD site, Realize.de. And our company stems from way back. We used to run cinemas, and then we were in distribution, then we went into digital. And once we went into digital, I guess at some point we felt that what was out there in terms of development mm-hmm. was not really fitting. At that point, we were like 20 people, out of which like 19 were working in content. Now we are actually 11 people, out of which 7 are developers. So having said that, I think when we looked at our own site and when we rebuilt our own site, of course, recommendations became an instant issue. And looking around what was there, you know, we felt that wasn't not something that we could use. Then on the other hand, like, we were lacking the experience. So luckily, we teamed up with the Technical University here in Berlin, with the German Institute for Artificial Intelligence, and started, in fact, create our own set of algorithms. One thing that might be interesting for algorithms is, like, we hear a lot about big data. Normally, data in this terms refers to user data, user behavior, user patterns, sure, matched with content that is within the system. I mean, that's what Netflix is so good at. Mm-hmm. But as we have seen in the presentation just now, we're talking about like millions of users, uh-huh, actually with Netflix, very few titles, but that's a different story. So you can process, you can extract information from millions of users, and how that is done is in this so-called collaborative filtering that is based on a good amount or large quantities of data. Well, I mean, most of here in the room, like, regardless if you're like a world sales or if you're like a producer or like us, if you're like a VOD outlet that concentrates on independent film, mm-hmm, well, I mean, your big data is a rather small data, I would say, mm-hmm, you know. But still, you know, we might have like 10,000 users, so, I mean, they use the platform, etc. But the downside of collaborative filtering is it's not very good with new items, with few users, with new users. There's the so-called cold start problem. So when we looked at our own operation, we thought what we want our algorithms to do is less look at the users. I mean, that we do too, mm-hmm, but actually look outside of the platform. So our algorithms, they actually refer to databases that are outside. They refer to Twitter accounts from festivals, they refer to blogs from newspapers, they refer from blogs of filmmakers, and they extract this information in a graph-based way, if that means something for you, and then they match that with user behavior, mm-hmm, and try to give useful information. The other thing, as we have seen, is that Netflix is really concerned about what to do with the user once inside the system. Mm-hmm. Well, if you're small, you're actually interested in the users that are not inside the system. So how can they benefit from the algorithms? And so what we do is we have the algorithms in an unpersonalized way. So if you come to the site, you might have reference to whatever currently happens outside. Mm-hmm. When you're inside, we will give you the choice if you would like to have a personalized approach with these recommendations or not. So I feel, yeah, in the European perspective, I can say, I mean, you know, we work with the university here in Berlin. I can only recommend that people find partners to do, mm-hmm, so if they don't have the knowledge yet. And I think there's a lot of competence and knowledge in Europe, and always taking the US as the role model, I'm not also for it, yeah.
Okay, and we'll leave that into recommendation and decision making when it comes to the audiences through algorithm in a second, but I do understand that you'd rather think out of the box and build your own algorithm than be a copycat from patterns already existing. Dimitrios, let's follow up with you actually, again, on this very question of whereas we should go for European patterns and models when it comes to algorithm or stick to the American ones. Do we have to, target the and just have the question in that very, you know, specific divide?
Just to give you a very brief background about myself and my company, basically we are building box office prediction algorithms that help film distributors pick better release dates for their titles. And the concept is basically that if you release the same film in different 52 weeks of the year, you get 52 box office results. And to your question, for us, building specific algorithms, not only by region, but all the way down to by country and even by city, is really important. Uh-huh. And it's important for three reasons. The first one is data availability. There are different data sets available in the US, that in France, in Germany, in the UK, etc. Then the second point is that is the legislation around data usage. In China, for example, if you have the data, basically you can do whatever you like with it. In Europe, there are much more strict restrictions. Mm-hmm. And finally is the performance of the algorithms themselves. If we have all the data we want and we can use it, we may find that certain metadata perform in a different way. For example, if I have box of, say, football fixtures for the UK and for the US, they my box office prediction may be more correlated to that in the UK than in the US. So
yeah, we do have to be to go tailor-made on certain type of algorithm depending on the location you're trying to again give some context to those data and extract them, of course. And let's follow up with Mustafa this time. So a Google guy, a Googler, now working for a broadcaster.
Yes, this was never a part of my career plan. Oh, but then again,
I thought you just you told us that you were working for Google.
Yes, no, oh, okay. That I did, but it was never a part of my career plan to work for a public broadcaster. Okay. Then again, you know, this is probably the most exciting. I mean, it's really interesting when I'm on these panels or when I'm giving talks and speeches myself. We victimize ourselves to a certain extent. We rightfully do so because. I'm not sure, Andres, whether I understood you right, because there is a lot we can learn from what is happening in the United States and elsewhere. But then again, yes, I do wholeheartedly agree that we need our very own or European approach. That we definitely need. But then again, we are just not as proficient as what is happening in the United States when it comes to, you know, application of algorithms to whatever, you know, our media institutions do right now and are supposed to do in the future. Case in point, I mean, there are a couple of examples, for instance. One issue where we really suffer a lot is that when it comes to digital platforms and digital distribution, we as Europeans are just not happening. None of the video platforms that most of you use is a European video platform. Netflix is a US platform. Amazon Prime is a US platform. The last mile, even the new product innovations that are happening in your living rooms, you know, speaking of Google Home or Amazon Alexa, all the systems that actually can be utilized to build speech models for our very own European languages are not being built by us. And that's not because we in Europe or European academia is not good or clueless about these things. Actually, most of the algorithms within, you know, content-based filtering, collaborative filtering and whatnot, most of these algorithms have a huge history and many of them have been invented at in European institutions. But then again, you know, we're not, let's leave it at a diplomatic term, we're not really that good in turning these things into products, you know, in having academia inspire and drive innovation in business or in public service media institutions, and then again have certain very, very important insights that only can be generated within a business or public service media context, again, pay back into academia. We don't have that cycle in Europe. Is broken, and it's not as broken in the U.S. And the U.S. public service media is broken. We're very strong when it comes, and that's a huge asset for Europe. But, you know, I guess we need to differentiate a little more. We need to see where our strengths are, and we need to see what we can learn from what's happening elsewhere and act accordingly.
And you know how much I love to find solutions during the panel, so how to, you know, cope with it? How can we actually have an effective and a predictive ecosystem where we can definitely try to benefit from the fact that we are good at designing algorithms, that we are good at thinking and working on data science. Like, for instance, I mean, Facebook, I mean, we're talking about Netflix all the time, but there are also other, you know, part of the ecosystem that benefit from algorithms and from the interaction they do put with content. Facebook, for instance, opened its AI lab research in Paris because of Yann Lecun, who's an amazing French data scientist and AI expert. So again, how can we actually, you know, cope with the problem you just point out and be more efficient?
All right, there is no single closed answer that anyone, yeah, I guess, could give. But then again, a good first step would be for all of us to understand and to communicate to the, to our audiences that this is something that we need to do. I guess the audiences, they know, because our audiences in Europe are using these, you know, US-driven platforms, sure, themselves, and very actively so. But our institutions, let me speak for public service media in Europe or in Germany in particular, they've never been set up in a way where we do understand or remodel our organizations and restructure our organizations to be driven by technological innovation. Uh-huh. You know, we've been for many, many decades, not just years, for many, many decades, we've been leading innovation in many technological areas that are part of, you know, broadcast technology. But when it comes to software product innovation, mm-hmm, we're just not there yet. So the very first step would be for us to understand that this is an important skill and an important issue that we need to very actively engage in and reorganize our organizations for.
That's one part of the answer. Thank you so much, Mustafa. I'm sure you would like to react to it, but first, let's hear from you, Paul. You actually worked on a study for Le CSA, who is targeting the part of algorithm and the way they do impact and interact with this content industry ecosystem. Could you just please tell us a little bit more about it, and then we'll dive into this very crucial debate Mustafa just pointed out.
Yeah, thank you very much. The CSA, the French Regulatory Authority, last year decided to create a kind of think tank, the CSA Lab, and to reflect on the mutations, which is, I mean, on the digital, the audiovisual economy and regulation linked to the digital shift. And the first topic this lab has worked on is about the role of algorithms and data in the access to content. So what we try to focus on is the link with the need or no need for, I mean, a change, uh-huh, in the regulation. Uh-huh.
Could I add some context to this? Because actually the CSA in France does regulate broadcasters, but would love to extend its powers to the internet industry, if I may.
But. Yeah, I mean, not would love to, but we're considering it given the mutations of the audiovisual industry, of course. Mm-hmm. So that's part of the game. And at the moment, we're undergoing at the European level a revision of the audiovisual media, uh-huh, sure, services directive, and which, if I may say, on uh-huh, there is a provision on in this directive about the promotion of European works,
uh-huh,
and
sure,
this is, I think, a crucial point in the role of algorithms. We were talking about Netflix, mm-hmm, and I mean, it's a US-based company having its European headquarters in the Netherlands, and therefore applying the Dutch regulation on the promotion of European works, on demand services, there is no, for the moment, no obligation on promotion of the European works. It's left to the state to decide.
Okay.
And it's in the project of the Commission to make it compulsory. So I mean it's up to us. I mean, not for us regulators at the moment, but for the states and then to the regulators to implement it. to see how the algorithms can help with the promotion of European works, how we can work together with those new actors and new mm-hmm. services to better promote European and national works.
And you just bring up a point that I love, working together. Can we work together? Actually, again, it's a question of will also to work together and to make those algorithms more efficient for audience engagement purposes, for marketing, film marketing purposes, for a better, again, industry and maybe monetization too of this industry. Can we actually take up this challenge, Andres?
Well, I think for sure we can. I mean, going back to the US dominance, of course, I mean, you do have to ask yourself, I mean, there we are. I mean, we are consuming media with Amazon, Netflix, uh-huh. and Google, and then some of us still do whatever as a German pendant. And what's offered is, so let's say it's 80%, it's American-run platforms offering, you know, 80%+ American content. Well, I mean, would you think that's arbitrary? There's, you know, mm-hmm. is that just by chance that is so, or is there something else to it, you know? So, I'm wary of this collaborative approach because everything gravitates towards a certain median, mm-hmm. not only with platform consumption, but as we had earlier, with analytics, like which script will be turned into a movie, which movie will succeed in the box office, which movie will get a bigger marketing budget. It always gravitates towards the median. But what is the median in Europe? I mean, how can we define a median in a environment where we have, I don't know, like 28 languages and actually, I don't know, 27 or 28 member states. Anyhow, many member states. Uh-huh. As we have cultural diversity, uh-huh. It is gravitating to the medium, meaning like what about minorities? What about different like role models? What about like tolerance, etc. pp. I mean, is that represented in the medium, or is there a pull doing so, the collaborative filtering and relying on the medium, because that's what happens. What gets pushed to the front is what correlates best with most of the users, and you can predict. Once you have that, you can predict what else most of the users would like. So mm-hmm. a new film, a new style, a new filmmaker, and even a new user who's possibly from a minority background does not hold a single chance to ever find something that's somehow representative for him in this setup. So that's why I would say, I mean, you know, it's an achievement that like the EU like holds all these different cultures mm-hmm. and countries together, and so. One has to look at like what is good for my specific audience, like what data would they like. I mean, if you look at our platform, I mean, the audience is young. I mean, it's like exclusively in the big metropolitan mm-hmm. areas. So what are they interested in, you know? And for example, one thing that I would say is like they're interested in relevance. They're not that much interested in like, okay, what do others do, but some of them are interested in like that we tell them, well, this film that we have on our platform, the cameraman just has a new film out here at the mm-hmm. Berlinale. That's what they're interested in. And like data can facilitate that in a clever way. And I think that's more where we should go. Of course, I understand there's mainstream and mainstream needs, but I think we need to redefine like what kind of mathematical formulas uh-huh. work best for our diverse culture and setup.
So mainstream versus hyper personalization. Where do you? How would you define it first, and how would you cope with it again? Maybe first, Dimitrios. This question about, you know, an algorithm will go mainstream by design, because I mean, you have to aim at the question you first designed to him, and it's more about trying to find something which is replicable. So algorithm would go mainstream, but we're at an age of data where we can go really focus into audiences and go to hyper personalization. So there's a huge debate here between how we should, you know, try to follow the trends. So what's your point of view on this debate? Again, mainstream on one side, hyper-personalization on another.
It really depends on data availability. If if you are working on with a data set like the one we saw earlier from Netflix, then you have a lot of information in your hands, and of course it makes sense to hyper-personalize the output of the algorithms. And of course, in many, many cases, though, the real problem is that we don't. In the data science industry, if you like, there is this common saying that the data scientists spend probably 80% of their time just cleaning data, getting data sets from different sources, from sources that sometimes they don't have all the metadata they need, and then they have to merge the data sets and work with that one data set. Now, in terms of working together, it does make more sense to share the data, and of course share the APIs as well, the algorithms via APIs, to do that.
Okay, Mustafa.
When it comes to, I mean, I don't think that we need to fear that everything gets mainstreamed. I think with digital platforms are a huge opportunity, and even Netflix shows that, for personalization or hyper-personalization. When it comes to when it comes to public service media, as a very particular case, then that's something we need to be very aware of. We don't want to push people into a very hyper-personalized field, which again means there's a huge case for a European approach to certain, you know, let's say recommendation algorithms, because our mission, for instance, is not defined as in, you know, not in monetary terms. It's not defined as us definitely and dedicatedly having to keep people on our platforms as much as we can to have them see as many commercials as they potentially could. No, it's much more delicate. It's much more diverse, our mission, and that means our objective function, you know, that's what you'd call in mathematics, our objective function, our target function, is much more complicated. You know, European public service media institutions have a mission that is engraved in law, and that again means that we can't just use the same algorithms that get applied in private business. So that's one part. So we don't have to fear mainstream media or mainstream distribution. It's rather hyper-personalization, and how do we ensure that we don't push people into their very own echo chambers, but instead make sure that there is a certain level of serendipity. Sometimes people think that, you know, applying recommendation algorithms and applying AI or ML machine learning models in and out of themselves would be a bad thing and would foster pushing people into their own filter bubbles, which is not true. There is no harm in knowing exactly what your audience wants to consume. Actually, it's really good to know. Let's say, for instance, let's say I might be a social democrat. So it might be important to occasionally have me also see conservative viewpoints, you know, to ensure that I'm an informed citizen in a liberal democracy. So that's one part. Another part is, let's get a little more technical. One of the issues, again, another aspect where collaboration actually would be very important, is that within all kinds of production studios, within all kinds of distribution institutions, we have treated metadata as, you know, as an also-ran. It's never been super important. But, you know, in mathematics, if you know anything about mathematical proofs, or remember how mathematical proofs were led in school, there are criteria that are necessary, and then there are criteria that are sufficient. We need to, you know, first of all, solve the necessary aspects, and that is, for instance, come up with metadata standards that we actually live by, that we actually provide our content with, because we have all that data in our production houses and distribution houses and other institutions, and then provide it to, you know, to those who are really responsible for tackling the last mile. That's the necessary part. We need to have clean metadata for either content-based or algorithms to work, or even collaborative filtering algorithms to work.
Andreas, I see you taking notes, loads of notes. Do you want to have a quick reaction on Mustafa's perspective?
Well, the thing is, of course, I actually disagree with this. I actually disagree with the concept of this echo chamber, because I feel like the whole like current discussion, and it's like such a buzzword, and you hear it in every like politician talk. in some ways we've always lived in an echo chamber. You know, if I go to the bakery and the guy hands me like 3 Schrippen and 2 croissants, because, you know, that's what I get all the time. I mean, there I am in an echo chamber. So in some ways I feel, you know, I'm all for personalization. I mean, really, I mean, I think a modern platform offering content, or actually any modern approach, like a distributor offering a film to the market, it has to be personalized. You know, that's what and it can be personalized, mm-hmm. but I think it can be done in a more responsible, or not even responsible, that I don't want to say. I don't want to say like others are irresponsible, that for sure not. I mean, it can be done in a more, in a way that actually reflects the user base that we are dealing with. And then again, I feel like most of us, you know, would find it a success if their respective films, let's say, would have like 10,000 admissions at the box office. I mean, that in Germany for a documentary film is actually not bad, you know? Mm-hmm. So, and there's the data, and there's the people who are interested in that, and how do you get them? That, I think, is more the issue. So if you can then have a personalized approach and give people, for example, in our case, uh-huh. like a personalized interface, that's what we're working right now on, I think that's a very good thing. The other thing was data and data availability. I think we, for example, are now working with our second project with the university, uh-huh. where we circumvent the problem that if you want to have data, you always feel like you have to kind of, you know, have an API, like get the data, etc., from some source. You know, in the end, what we do right now is we try to find I would call it a front door solution. So basically what we do is like we go, let's say, I hate to say it, but I mean, we go to the Berlinale archive, everything's in there. So what the program does, it condenses everything that's in the Berlinale archive. It strips it all from all the functions. It reduces it to mere text, structures the text, throws it into a data dump, has like AI, I guess, sort it out, create relevant graph grids, and then like match those graph grids with the user graph, which is a very, you know, good thing that came out of Facebook. Mm-hmm. And there you have something interesting. There I am able to tell this one person who's actually accessing a film, saying like Andres Feil, I can, like, you know, we have the Balagan in our system, a very early film of him, we can say, well, the new film is currently in the competition at the Berlinale. I mean, I tell them anyhow because I know, but I mean, that's not everything I can know, and there's so many festivals. So I think in the end, it's about like how you access data, and I think, for example, our approach to reduce it to text, and then because that's the nice thing about AI. I mean, like the AI can read the entire Berlinale catalog in 5 seconds, uh-huh. and that's only reading. I mean, sense making comes later, but I think that's a good thing, and we can work with it, and yeah. So,
Paul, I'm sorry because you're taking notes too, but do you want to jump on the debate for a quick second?
Yeah, I was interested by the reference to the bakery you were making. Like, it's not a problem if you like croissant, of course, but if one day you step into the bakery and you see those Danish rolls next to the croissant and you don't know about them, but maybe you want to try them one day. You never know, so it's all about, yeah, leading people to discover all the things that they may not know and may not know that they like. So I think it's important too. And as you were saying, Dimitrios, we have to share data, we have to share APIs, algorithms, and I think it's important for everybody to build trust around how the use of algorithms, and to know that they will be loyal to what you expect from them. So for the users to know what they really do, and how they pick the movies or the works that you're going to see that you offer, mm-hmm. on your screen. And I think for that we have, I mean, there is of course the trade secrets, and we are not supposed to access everything. But still, it would be important for the future to be able to have a look under the hood of algorithms and just a peek of into the black box to know the criteria or why I am offered this on my Netflix profile, for instance, so that we can more work together.
Demetrius, of course, quick question here, and then we'll throw the ball on how, to what extent an algorithm can be trustworthy.
Yeah, so I just want to say that on the data sharing and the fact that companies are very reluctant to share their information with others, it's always important to understand that this is not a zero-sum game. If we share data, it basically means that we'll find different ways to get audiences interact with our tools, whet their appetite, and get them to consume perhaps a little bit more. We've done studies on the cinema side of our business, and we found that picking better release dates across a whole country can improve the box office of that country by 4 to 8%, depend the annual box office takings by 4 to 8%. And this is for the whole market moving up. Sometimes in our side of the business, when two films open on the same date, basically they cannibalize each other. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's important to avoid it.
So. Sure. So the philosophical question of the panel, can we trust algorithm? How far can we trust them? And just to be a little more maybe illustrative here, could you just, you know, lead us or walk us into the process of building an algorithm so that we can totally understand what inputs you do put at first or program at first into an algorithm so that then we can be more effective towards what we're trying to pursue here in this economy? Yeah, Demetrius.
Yeah, I mean, for us on in the cinema business, it's been always very difficult to persuade senior execs who've been working with their gut feeling for a number of years to trust algorithms. And our approach is this. First of all, we treat our algorithms, our tools, as an additional tool in the way they work. Secondly, we run what we call cross-validation analysis. We take historical data, pretend we don't know what happened, and basically we try to see if our algorithms perform well. But ultimately, you gain trust by being right over and over again. This is how it has worked for us in the past. It's difficult, I think, because we are asking people to change the way they think and the way they work. Uh-huh. And this is where the real challenge is in terms of using data tools in making business decisions.
Andres.
Well, I mean, in the end, I mean, algorithm is just math. You know, I personally find math beautiful, so I love it. So, you know, any recommendation is like a whole like sequence of algorithms. Uh-huh. It's not just one. I mean, I think it's important to again look at your target group, either if you're a distributor or like if you're a platform, and see what does rank where. I mean, because like, in some ways, an algorithm, like if you think about a film, then we create like a you could say a graph, you know, uh-huh. like that has like edges and nodes, like each, let's say, and you make the connections, and basically what the algorithm does is like try to find like in that system like tries the fastest way, so to speak. And but by doing so, you need to give the algorithm some guidance, you know, and that's where you come in, like you say, like, how do I prioritize, you know, like what for my user is more important, and how do I rank, and like for the different users, like how do I rank what. And this is where I personally think it's enough if you're like open to the users. I don't know if you need to like publish the whole sequence, they might not understand it or so. But I think like what's nice and what you can do is like as like a recommendation system is a set of algorithms and a set of functions. You can actually either allow the user to say, do I want this or not? And you can of course allow the user to interact with the set of functions. You can, for example, say, well, let's say the item-to-item recommendation, which is like easy because it relates one film to the other. Mm-hmm. Like you can fade that in, and like my preference is I can fade those out, and the relation to the outside, which I guess is a specialty of ours, like where, you know, like outside influx, I would like to have more of that. And what mm-hmm. I would like to have more of that, let's say maybe for example, we feed the Tagesschau in there, so, you know, but maybe I'm not so interested in politics, but I'm more interested in festivals, etc. So I think you can actually, in the end, empower the user uh-huh. to the point of either say, well, I don't want it at all, or you could say, well, why don't you try it out mm-hmm. and see how you feel about it, and then you might actually find it useful seeing your then personalized surface change by the tools that we give you. That in the end, I think, would be a good thing.
But again, in one, just one day, I can be a multiple thing. I can be a movie theater consumer. I can be a gamer. I can be a news consumer. I can go and watch some entertainment on Netflix or whatever. So could we think about bringing together a meta algorithm that will follow a content consumer throughout his whole journey? Do we already have it?
It's called the social and interest graph.
Yeah.
You know, and
so the graph
Facebook is really good at that, and that follows you, you know, wherever. I mean, if you like it or not, you know. Mm-hmm. So, but again, I think if you can empower the user, I'd be someone who say like, oh, okay, please, my personal graph, follow me. You know, I don't care.
Okay.
But others might feel more reluctant, and I think if you empower the user to make the choice, then mm-hmm. all is good.
Which also means way more collaboration for data sharing between platforms and broadcasters and film producers, I guess.
Sure. I mean, I think, I don't know if there's like enough, I mean, I don't know if people want to share data. I mean, data is always available. That's the other thing. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, I feel it's, I mean, there's processes where you can access data. Uh-huh. I mean, I wouldn't say like even if somebody tries to hold a lid on it, I mean, but... you know, everything that's like Google, everything that's publicly available, in the end you can process it. Mm-hmm. Like anything that's out there, you can process. I mean, you just have to find the right ontologies, the right meanings, the right references. And if you do so, and then like, what do you want to process for your specific audience? Mm-hmm. That's the challenge. And of course, in the end, you know, like we're only talking about text. The end, as we have seen in the first presentation, will be that you look at not only a text, but you look at audiovisual content, and you can apply the same methods. You can look at films, access mm-hmm. films, analyze films, and make that happen, yeah.
Mustafa.
You know, I'm a computer scientist by trade, mm-hmm. so I have a graduate degree. I love algorithms too. But then again, we can't be naive about the power of the application of certain algorithms on certain sets of signals and the effects that they have on digital platforms that are being utilized for the distribution of media. I mean, case in point, Facebook in the US election. Facebook most definitely has lost a lot of trust in the US in certain segments of society because people, I'm not saying this happened, but certain people say, God, this pushed me really, or this pushed others, maybe true or not, into certain filter bubbles where they only consumed alt-right information or whatnot, and in the end got Donald Trump elected. So that's definitely a problem. We have super important elections coming up in Europe, and this is a discussion that is being uh-huh. led in society, and we're thinking about, well, are they going to be external powers? Do we need to be wary of so-called external powers who might potentially game the algorithms mm-hmm. that are being used for the information that in the end reaches, you know, over the last mile, consumers and audiences? So these are all
the
things...
balance of algorithm of the balance of powers?
Excuse me?
A balance of algorithms as a balance of power.
Well, you might put it that way, but the interesting part there is, you know, the question that we, all of us, need to ask ourselves as citizens of liberal democracies in Europe is it a problem that, for instance, is the lack of transparency of algorithms that are being utilized on these platforms and the parameter settings that these algorithms are working on, is the lack of transparency a problem for us or isn't it? And this is, you know, it's not an easy answer. It's actually a hugely challenging answer or question to be answered. Because on the one hand, there are trade secrets, there are competitive advantages mm-hmm. that private companies have over each other. And on the other hand, there is, you know, the control of what audiences in the end receive as information and whatnot. Because a certain control is being exerted on on the information that reaches audiences. And this control is in the hands of private companies with very little regulation.
Well, actually, when you tackle the question of transparency, could it be solved through blockchains, for instance? What about, you know, just trying a blockchain of content? Would it be relevant first?
That's an entirely different topic. I wouldn't mix it into this issue. Okay. It's another super exciting topic, but it's not, you know, there is no silver bullet. These things are highly complicated matters.
Okay, I do understand. Paul?
Yeah, I think that could, I mean, there could be a field for European action, for the European level to make something about to ensure transparency and loyalty of the algorithms in a broad way. There is a provision in French law, in a recent law for a digital republic, which was published in October.
Mm-hmm. With Axel Le Maire.
Yeah, exactly, October last year. And I think it's not only a national problem. It's if you want to go cross borders, we need to have a European approach to this, I think. And the other question is that we were raising is the degree of automation when you only have a top-down approach, like an algorithm which is imposing all the choices to the users. Uh-huh. You're not empowering the users, and I think it's one of the important aspects that we have. It should be the opportunity to empower users to give them like a bit of room for choice, not to go to leave this echo chamber and see that as an opportunity, yes, to have your own parameters and to be able to set them. And it would be a way to complement this top-down approach by a bottom-up approach as well. So,
sure. Who wants to jump in? Maybe a little Demetrius, and whenever you want to ask your questions to our guests, please just raise your hand, because Q&A timing is practically open.
On the doctoring of algorithms and basically in the financial data science sector, they have been talking about a case where there was a hedge fund who was trying to basically count how many times Berkshire Hathaway was appearing in the news, and they would buy their stock. Mm-hmm. They made a mistake in their algorithm, and every time Anna Hathaway was coming up, the stock of Berkshire would go up, so just for a little bit, uh-huh. and then would go down. Another company picked that up, and as soon as there was a movie coming up, they would short the stock of that company just to benefit from that that pick. I think there are going to be many ways, creative ways, that people are going to try and pick these algorithms and try to fine-tune their behavior for various purposes. We just need to be aware of that. So.
Sure. Do we have any questions for our guests on set, or maybe also a question to Elena? That is pretty much possible. Sir, you do have a question. And you don't have a mic, but you will in a few sec.
Paul, you spoke about empowering the users, but we heard in the previous presentation that actually users have a 60 to 90 second window where they make their choice. How do you reconcile the two?
Do you remember during the Elena's presentation, we saw that every single user has a 60 to 90 second frame where they are going to make their choice. So how do you balance that story with the empowerment of audiences? Because we are doing we were making up our minds pretty quick. So
indeed. I've seen a presentation by a French company a few weeks ago about another type of algorithms, which is not the one used by Netflix, but where you can have the company is called Spideo, and it's not kind of statistics search that is used by Netflix. It's more based on a semantic search. So you're offered a few boxes and saying that I'm in the mood for like drama or humor, or, and then you click. And after like 4 or 5 questions like that, so maybe not more than 60 to 80 seconds, you have a selection of movies that corresponds to this to these choices. So, I mean, it could be as simple as that, or any different things. But it's I think it's a good pick.
Okay. Does anyone else have a question for our guests on stage? No question at all. Oh, one question here.
Hi, first, thank you very much for the very interesting panel. I have actually a question for all the panelists. Could you recommend any creative tools for people creating stories and movies that could use algorithms to inspire or find ideas or decide on what they're going to do?
So do you have one secret weapon that you could share with our audiences today to you know, be more effective while creating stories and while reaching audiences?
Well, I mean, I can say, you know, like the most creative, I guess, would be like the pen and the paper, you know, really. So, I mean, I really would not recommend using algorithms for the story. So, I mean, I feel I always have, when I'm on a panel, I mean, there's often this discussion, for example, with World Sales, where they say, yeah, we come in really early into the production process, even when it's just in the narrative stage of things. And I feel like, leave the artist alone, you know? I mean, like, once it's out there, then deal with it. Because, I mean, in the end, what is art? I mean, like, if you look at film as art, I'm not like saying that every film has to be art, and, you know, for sure, I mean, I love, like, Eddie Murphy and all that stuff. But in the end, I feel it is, and right now I feel it's important. I mean, like, and I think that's why, like, the European film is important and relevant. It is a look of an individual into the world willing to share that view with others. And that can be really meaningful. And your meaning will definitely be sidelined if you're looking for mathematical help how your subjective view of the world should be told or shaped. So I would really not recommend it. If you are interested in trying to create Daredevil and Godzilla, I mean, go all ahead. I mean, that's the right strategy for sure, you know. But in general, I would say no.
Dimitris, pen, paper, algorithm, or a mix of it?
Well, I think pen and paper for me as well.
Okay.
I think it's the creative side of the business is a side that right now is still in exploration phase, if you like, on the data science world. I mean, from the previous panel, we saw a very interesting clip. But again, this is it's something that we probably be able to talk about in 10, 20, 30 years' time from now.
So even tech guys are recommending pen and paper. Wonderful. Mustafa?
I do disagree. And I think there's actually an excellent example where that disagreement actually came to fruition in a very, very interesting show, and that's House of Cards. There will always be room for pen and paper. But if you really want to know or actually explore mechanisms to analyze a potential audience that you could reach with a certain message that you want to get across, or a set of messages, then there's no harm in analyzing the data available to you. The problem is that to most of you, that type of data is just not available because it belongs to, you know, the last mile where you can actually generate that data and analyze that data or generate it for analysis purposes. That's not being generated on a platform that you own or have access to. That's the true problem.
Andreas, and then Dimitrios.
Well, I feel the House of Cards example to me is actually a really negative example, because, I mean, if you look at it, I mean, okay, they drafted all the opinions of the median population, and so what came out of it? A series that basically said most politicians are crooks, you know, they're all like after their own interests, you know, the whole political system is corrupt. I mean, face it, I mean, what's the outcome of this? I mean, we all know.
I mean, like, there you have House of Cards, like, millions are watching, binge-watching House of Cards, thinking, man, the president, you know, he's just a phony. And then in the end, well, there you have the phony.
And actually, with House of Cards, I think it was a remake of an old BBC series.
Yeah, the very first
I think the algorithms picked the cast, but not they were not involved in the creative process of writing the film.
Yeah, I completely agree with you, and I think that there was quite a low risk taking David Fincher starring, directing the film, starring Kevin Spacey, and having a remake of a former successful British series. I think it was not that daring, but I mean, personally, I love House of Cards, and I binge watch it on Netflix. But still, it's I think pen and paper is still the best tool to use for now.
So we have three pen and papers guys on stage and one full technology guy. But still, we are better testing this kind of innovation. And maybe right now, where we stand is at this point is maybe trying to be a little bit more, again, risk happy, but trying to blend together a little bit of technology and a little bit of pen and paper at this point. Do we still have another question that we could tackle with our guest on stage before we do too? The closing remarks of this morning's sessions. We do have a question over there, sir. And we do have two mics for one person.
Hi. I think pen and paper doesn't exist anymore in the real production business, because if I take the kids programming sector, which is quite specific, when the broadcasters are facing major challenges in terms of platform, multi-platform use, how kids are now moving from TV to multi-platform. So in a way, they have to use this data to shape the kids' animation programming. And as a result, I mean, the creative side of it is that producers, which have to have broadcasters involved from the beginning of the development, have to consider all this data. So I don't believe in a pen on paper ideal situation, maybe a mix of.
And that's a real great reaction here, by the way, because it brings us to the question of engaging new audiences and younger audiences. How do we reach those audiences that aren't, consuming content through traditional broadcasting anymore, that are directly Netflixing, Amazon Priming, or Facebooking content? Where do we find them? How do we reach them? How do we engage them?
Actually, by moving where they already are. I mean, kids, I mean, I have a 2.5-year-old daughter, and she already loves YouTube. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're not letting her watch more than, I don't know, 20 minutes per day or something. But still, I mean, we need to have our shows. We, you know, our distribution channels are not just radio programming and linear programming in general on TV and elsewhere anymore. It's not just DAB or the TV equivalent DVB and whatnot that we'd be using. We need to be on digital platforms, and that again brings its own very unique, very different set of challenges. You know, compared to technological advances in radio technology or broadcast technology in general, technological innovation on digital platforms is moving at light speed versus glacial speed when it comes to the classical distribution mechanisms that we'd been using and where we've become very, very professional over the last many decades. So we need to be where our audiences are, again, be on third-party platforms, but also strengthen our very own platforms. It's not a, it's not an either-or. We need to be on both.
Okay. Anyone wants to come with the
reaction? Users, I mean, for example, I mean, I totally agree. I mean, go where the users are. I mean, now the users are, like, they're addressable with various means. And, for example, with our video-on-demand platform, the number one traffic source is Facebook. And Facebook ads, I mean, Facebook ads, I can highly recommend it. You can, like, target absolutely specific. You can do A-B testing. I mean, we have, like, hundreds of ads running every day, testing which one performs, which one doesn't, which imagery. I mean, there's all kinds of, I mean, it's just, like, know your audience, like, use all the analytics tools available, but, you know, try to do it in a conscious and responsive way. Then I think
it's a great time to, I mean, I always, like when I was running movie theaters, I mean, you know, you could always just stand at the checkout and talk to the audience and you'd have a pretty good idea what they want. And, you know, now if you have a couple of thousand customers, well, that's more difficult. So, but there are ways to reach out, to engage, to see what they like. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a really good way to do it.
And there's also a question of trying to keep up with, I mean, the pace this industry is going and where audiences are. Because, for instance, if we take, again, Facebook might be irrelevant for some part of audiences right now, young audiences that would be better on Snap than on Facebook because their mother is on Facebook, basically. And then now Facebook is not the trendy thing anymore to go and consume content on. Final word with you, Paul, before we do go to closing remarks.
Yes,
final words.
Final words. Yeah, I've not thought about it. But I think it's algorithms should be seen first as opportunities, both for viewers to find their way in such a diverse audiovisual world, and I think it will go on being more diverse in the future. And from the creator's point of view as well, it's been said already, but it's a new way of making the works discoverable, and it should be done in the right way, ensuring the more diversity. And for the public policies and public policy makers as well, it should be a way once more to ensure the promotion of our works, of European works. And of course, it should be done in the right way, not being naive, and taking into account all the negative aspects that shouldn't take the upper hand on it.
The balance of algorithm again here on this stage. Thank you so much for your insights and your perspective. Thank you very much for your reaction and questions, of course. Upcoming this afternoon, I mean, brilliant angles and brilliant interviews, which will tackle again the question of politics, on how algorithm, on how post-truths, on how, I mean, innovation, all those kind of concepts do impact on our content industry. And for now, we are about to get to closing remarks for this morning's session with Giuseppe Abbamonte, he's the Director Media Policy at DG Connect for the European Commission.
Thanks very much. Good afternoon, everybody. Well, it's a daunting task to be able really to wrap up after, you know, this trove of information and feedback. I have learned personally a lot in the course of the morning, and I listened very carefully to all the speakers. So the first thing is that, like theatrical performance, now in the digital era, the audience lives and informs also the creative process. So we applaud digitally and we throw our, you know, digital rotten vegetables, if you don't like something, using the blogs, the Twitter feeds, the Facebook timelines, the proprietary VOD platforms and apps. So there is really a wealth of feedback which may be mined and which may be built into predictive models. And it is something which is very relevant for the European films and for the European film industry, because European films, unfortunately, do not travel or travel very little in Europe and abroad. So basically, this may be used to market in a much more granular fashion our European content and reach out to wider audiences. So something which emerged clearly, in particular after listening to the to the lady who was speaking for speaking about Netflix, is that by slicing up and dicing content, we can get a much better understanding of content, which may be tagged with metadata. And the combination of a good a sound understanding of audience and content is a fantastic combination, because marketing becomes much more micro-segmented and dynamic and granular. And also, well, I don't know if there is, after the last panel I hesitate, but I think that there is something the algorithms may be used to, so we may sound out an algorithm on whether a script will work, whether a joke will work, and whether a trailer will be really effective. There is a tension which was expressed in particular in the first panel between, I think it was Oscar Sharp who used the word, which I will borrow in all my future speeches, sameness for big data and total originality. So the risk is that with sameness, we will go too far, you know, in our quest to please the mainstream. And with total originality, the risk is to produce a lot of white noise. So the creator basically will have to steer the ship in between two opposing currents. So again, we don't live in a black and white world. So the big data current, the sameness current, which is very much backward looking, and the total originality, which is very much forward looking. Again, big data requires big judgment. The human element is undodgeable, because after all, it will be the man or the woman who will have to design the algorithm and also deriving the insights, so interpret the results. Something which is true, which is lacking in Europe, is skills in the field of big data. So we have to work on that. So the data's the people who are really able to interpret the results of the algorithms apparently are lacking in Europe. And also, in terms of framework conditions, so there was a gentleman who asked the question. I didn't intervene, but I was tempted to do it. So who owns the data? And so there is really a key question that we have raised in a recent communication, which has just been issued by the Commission. So there is a public consultation on the issue of data access, data algorithm, and really I call on you to engage in this communication, because it is really relevant for all your business. And there is the issue of who owns the data and how do you share access to the data. So there was Andreas, who said that, it's not so difficult to get access to the data because data is everywhere, but it is not, to the best of my knowledge, entirely true, because a number of companies, in particular the manufacturers of the device for machine-generated data, who gets the data are very, very reluctant to share the data freely, because they consider them as a sort of competitive edge. So there is a matter which is very, very important. I think that, and it is something which is important for you, you should be much more involved in helping us steering the research and innovation agenda of the European Commission under Horizon 2020. So you have to be a bit more proactive and come and see us in Brussels, but also the media program. So the media program is being reviewed this year. So the new media program is being prepared. You have to come to us, you have to say, look, this is what you need to do. This is where the money has to be put in order to have the maximum impact in terms of fostering distribution, so that we make sure that European films basically travel more in Europe and beyond. So finally, two very interesting questions. A first question is a question to Netflix, but of course I don't expect an answer now, is that we have now a new proposal for a law on broadcasting, the Audiovisual Media Services Directive, which provides for quotas, so a quota of European films for VOD platforms, to get combined with prominence requirements. So basically Netflix and other VOD platforms in Europe will have to have a share of European films in their catalogs, and they will be required to give prominence in their catalogs to the European films. So how do we reconcile the hyper-personalization with the quotas? So and the prominence requirements on the VOD platform. So there is an interesting question for the future. And then there was the other question, which was very, very interesting, again raised by Oscar. So who owns the IP over the screenplays written by a computer, by Benjamin? And it is particularly interesting for me, because I am the director for copyright in Europe, and I don't have an answer to the question. So I would like really to thank all the panelists for the excellent presentations, in particular Dirk Hoffman for a very engaging graphic presentation, and I would like finally to thank Marjorie Payon for the fantastic moderating job. Thank you very much indeed, and bon appétit.